Salanta, fellow Rastafari. We just want to make a quick, I guess like a little audio presentation to just point out the similarities of the Nile River and Rastafari to be one and the same. I guess we could go ahead and point this out to begin with. The Nile rivers are composed of separate different water sources and streams and rivers. They all are, some of these sources originate in distinct and different geographical locations, different boundaries, different areas within the Empire of Ethiopia, and there are many different waterways that as a whole form this water system in that compasses the whole land of Ethiopia, and we're speaking of the Nile River. And eventually it fruits and multiplies into a series of living waters springing forth out of Zion, of course, and making it possible for life more abundantly, for growth and progress. And so basically, the fact that different waters from different areas come together and flow together and merge together as one and transform a desert, seemingly dead land, and transforming that into a paradise in which agriculture can be established, and a place in which civilization and progress can strive, being that its original state is barren and desert. And excuse me, and basically cannot support life. But this miraculous work of the Almighty is to be acknowledged. And so we bring forth this report, being that that was just mentioned. I guess we have to reference Prophet Isaiah chapter 53, who hath believed our report, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed. In this case, we would like to address strictly all elect Rastafari. Have we written our report? Have we brought forth our report? And if not, how do we expect the arm of the Lord to be revealed? To whom much is given of them, much is expected. And so it is the responsibility of all Rastafari to bring forth their reports and make and give all inhabitants of this earth the opportunity of receiving the truth, the good news of His Imperial Majesty Kedamawi Kaile Selassie and his Christ, Jesus Christus, Yehoshua HaMashiach. And so, this is something that failure is not an option. It is only fair and just that every individual on the face of this earth gets the opportunity to make an intelligent decision as to what they decide to chase or to go after, to desire. Will one's desire death? Will one's rather choose life? That is up to the individuals, but we as Rastafari must make it possible so that all inhabitants of this earth are given that opportunity of choice, and therefore they can make their voices heard, and in this case, the one listening is the Almighty. And so, each one's out there listening to this, take your case to the Almighty. Us Rastafari are just instructed to bring forth the truth, being that no one else, regardless of how many stickers they have on their wardrobe that says doctors, no matter how much money one spent in their miseducation, it is only Rastafari that can bring the complete and whole truth. And it is only Rastafari that can have claims in truth, in righteous truth. Of course, our righteousness being Yeta Jesus Christus, the Son of God, only we can claim, have accurate and rightful claims to to a life in which all members of the human community are treated as should be, equal to one another. And this could be symbolized in the Nile rivers, how they come together. Rivers, waters, streams from different origins, different places come together and serve for the ultimate goodness of the world and bring forth the ultimate purpose of the Almighty. We Ras Tefri are the only peoples that can proudly boast such claims. Only Ras Tefri exercises true equality. A lot of nations pretend, in all hypocrisy and ignorance and stubbornness, they pretend that they in fact exercise true equality, except in most cases it is a group of like-minded individuals, both physical and mental, saying this without even allowing other individuals so-called different from them to even have a voice in this opinion. And anyways, basically a lot of people say that they pretend to accept equality, but then their actions completely discredit their false words and their deceit. It is only Ras Tefri that has overcome all these all these potentially stumbling blocks, and we have come to our truth, as Rastafari Hebrews now, and living that healthy lifestyle, that Christian life, following in the good example set by Geta Jesus Christos. Now, we say that because Ras Tefri does not limit its initiates to a certain race, shape, size, form, whatever. I mean, whatever lynchism ones want to put out there, Rastafari does not divide. Rather, we unite and we flow together, as does the Nile River, which is needful to make mention that Ethiopia, the continent of Ethiopia, is the birthplace of all humanity. There are very many Gentile, intelligent yet spiritually ignorant individuals out there that at least are agreeing with the simple truth that all life springs out from Africa, from Ethiopia, and more precisely along the Nile River valleys. And so that is truth, and let it be that which it could only be. Now, Ras Tefri also, I guess we'll take this time to make mention that every positive influence that has ever been introduced to this 20th century has been via Rastafari. Rastafari is the only peoples bringing forth positive influences and vibrations to this earth, at least for the last 100 years. The world false world system, they themselves have not contributed a bit. Not a single thing has this false world contributed to the progress, our life and Ethiopia's progress, and so that is worthy of making mention. I mean, just think about it. When's the last time an actual song, a vocals musician in this case, sang about something positive? So that, I mean, Berhane Selassie, since that time, the airwaves musically have been charged with negativity, and is it going to take another Ras Tefri to make a change? It appears that Ras Tefri are the only willing to receive the truth and the complete change. So now let us kind of we kind of got sidetracked. We didn't think of even speaking on some of those random notes, but so be it. Let us continue. Basically, we're trying to get down to if one's open up scripture to the prophets, Prophet Jeremiah chapter 31. And we believe it's going to be verse 12. And it reads, "Therefore they shall come and sing in the height of Zion, and shall flow together to the goodness of the Lord, for wheat and for wine and for oil, and for the young of the flock and of the herd. And their soul shall be as a watered garden, and they shall not sorrow any more at all." So we're gonna point this out, but it's not to say that this is exactly like what is being meant here. We didn't do diligence to seek root meanings of the words and stuff like that. But one could imagine wheat kind of like white in a sense, pale, we could say, and then wine red, and oil black, a mixture of all peoples upon this earth, coming together, flowing together, as does the Nile River and Ras Tefari, as we merge into this change for the ultimate good of the world and fulfilling the ultimate purpose of the Almighty. It is only Ras Tefri that can rightfully make such claims. And now it is also interesting to note that when the Blue Nile and the White Nile merged together, you could actually see them coming together, and you could see the red water, which is coming from Lake Tana, and it is flowing northward. And when it merges to the White Nile, you could see the Blue Nile like having a red color, like completely filled and saturated with all the rich volcanic minerals coming from the highlands of Ethiopia. And then the White Nile having a kind of like a clear or blue color to it, and they flow together. And it is just something interesting to point out. Now, let us continue on to Isaiah chapter 60, Prophet Isaiah chapter 60. And we shall read verse 5, we believe. And it reads, "Then thou shalt see and flow together, and thine heart shall fear, and be enlarged, because the abundance of the sea shall be converted to thee. The forces of the Gentiles shall come to thee." And this is just prophecy. The good shepherd cares for his sheep, and regardless of how like or how different these sheep may be, since the days of old, Ephraim and, excuse me, Joseph was to be doubly fruitful, and Gitayesus fully fills that. He is the doorfold. He is that vine going over the wall. He is that fulfillment, bringing all peoples together. You see, and one shouldn't be upset at that, because then ones would commit, not only commit themselves to a stumbling block, and stumbling on it and not stepping on it and going on forward, but ones would commit the mistake that Jonah did. Jonah would have rather seen the city of Nineveh be destroyed for his own pride, because we're guessing that ones we could assume that he was going to be made fun of because his prophecy was not did not come to pass. And so him being prideful, he would have rather seen the death of many. And so that is a mistake. I guess that it sounds like it's not relative, but it is, because the Almighty says to Jonah, "Listen, I gave you a shroud or something, like a covering, a shade or something." And Jonah got upset when he lost it. And so the Most High says, "You got upset about something that you didn't even work for. That I gave that to you. You didn't even do anything." How much more should I not be upset for losing, for having to lose thousands of what I've created? And he's speaking of the inhabitants of the city of Nineveh. And so basically it's kind of seeking to express how out of the belly of this whale here in the Americas, you know, we are not to be contaminated by these false, they're not even worthy of being called ideas. I mean, these false negativities that only divide and allow for ones to be conquered. You know, we must accept that we are to come and flow together as one, regardless of background, peoples, whatever. I mean, if ones wanna go on even forward, we are all sinners. No one has lived up to the expectation of the Most High. And so on the basis of Torah and the law of Moses, we are all condemned to death. And so it doesn't matter really who you are and what race you are. We are all equal. We are all convicted of death. But in the grace and mercy of the Almighty, we are all offered and allowed the opportunity of salvation. And so basically there's no way any people can claim a higher status, a superiority from other people, you know, basically. And so and there's way more. This isn't even what we were seeking to speak on. And so let us continue on with the Nile River. Give we just 1 second. Okay, yeah, now we're gonna go on forward to the book of Joshua, excuse me. And this is chapter 24, verse 1. And Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel in Shechem and called for the elders of Israel and for their heads and for their judges and for their officers. And they presented themselves before God. And Joshua said to all the people, "Thus said the Lord God of Israel, your fathers dwelt on the other side of the flood in old time, even Terah, the father of Abraham, and the father of Nahor, and they served other gods." Now, basically, we just want to introduce this because all of Scripture is referencing sites and cities within the geographical locations recognized falsely as Africa, but more correctly as Ethiopia. Excuse me. Excuse me. We were saying something like that all scripture is referencing Ethiopia, and it's not limited to what the wicked them make pretend, make believe that Ethiopia is not. Ethiopia, it consists of what ignorant individuals knowledgeable in this false world system recognize as Africa, not limited to but rather includes the islands off to the west coast of Africa, Madagascar, any islands surrounding the continent of Ethiopia. And this also includes the beach coast area, falsely titled wrongfully the State of Israel. It consists of all of that area as well, and even down to the peninsula, wrongfully misnamed erroneously Arabia or Saudi Arabia, whatever it is that they want to pretend that it's not. All of that is, in fact, Ethiopia, at least. I mean, it's not limited to. The borders might go beyond that, but that gives ones a more accurate idea of the geographical location of Ethiopia and what it is that is being referenced in scripture in its entirety. Now, it just came to mind that these peoples in Exodus chapter 20 or 19, you know, the Almighty had chosen a certain people to be a priesthood to him. And these people, the first thing they did, they set up a legality, and therefore gave up grace. But basically, we're just trying to say that that they pretended or they took liberties of setting up rules and regulations. The Almighty went forth and said, okay, you want to set up boundaries and limits and stuff like that, then I'll tell all the item how far they can go and what they can and can't do, like how far and to what extremes. And so basically, that just further proves that the boundaries of Ethiopia are not limited to, except only the will of the Almighty. And so with that, we are and we excuse me, we kind of got distracted because of that interruption. But we were referencing the book of Joshua, and it spoke of the floods of old times. Okay, basically, here we go. The Jordan River, falsely so called, we don't accept it to be the Jordan River. You know, for a river so historically significant, ones would expect to find a lot more on it, but we find otherwise. It is very unimportant and no one really cares about it. But I'll tell you about a stream of living waters that is worldwide reverenced and respected and known and I guess like praised as the most important river systems of the world, and that is the Nile rivers. You know, that we just have to say this. We accept the Jordan River, falsely so called. We claim that it is the Nile River. That, you know, just to be kind to these ignorant individuals, so-called doctors, lawyers, whatever they pretend to be, just to be kind to them, we're gonna pretend that you know, that they just made a mistake and that they really don't know. But what they were intending, what they should have been intending to say, is that the Jordan River, where Getasus was baptized, is in fact the Nile River, and there's no way around it. As mentioned previously in those verses of the book of Joshua, Terah and Nahor, the fathers of Abraham, that they dwelt on the other side of this river, in the floods of days of old. These floods, it is only the Nile River that overfloods once a year, and allows for these verses to be possible. Now, passing over, you know, it's pretty basic and obvious, but we know the unbelief and the lunacy and stubbornness of many out there. And so we're gonna just seek to expand on that and share more evidence that'll point to that. And take note that if physical evidence is lacking, it's not because it doesn't exist, but it's because researchers refuse to excavate Africa, especially the Sahara Desert, and especially all of Africa, not limited to the Sahara. But everyone knows, everyone that is kind of studied somehow, that pretend to be knowledgeable in whatever limited, I guess, like little specialization that they are exposed to, whatever their area of expertise or lack thereof is, they all know that if they excavate Africa, Ethiopia more correctly, if they research Ethiopia, that they will be confronted with truth. And God forbid that these false authorities, so-called, God forbid that they point out truth and that they actually come across truth, because that is unbearable to these individuals. So they rather just continue in denial and refuse to accept what they already know. I mean, most of these individuals know. They just, you know, they kind of they avoid it, basically. So that is just, we just had to point that out. Now, Havila, the land of Havilah. It is clearly connected to Ethiopia. Some of these root meanings, mentioned kind of like a circle, a whirlwind, and we could see that throughout the Nile rivers. Now it says a district in Arabia, the northwestern part of Yemen, a part of Eden, which flowed from the Pishon or Pison River. Now, we know that the Garden of Eden is in fact the bed garden, the elevated garden, the highlands of Ethiopia, and the garden itself is all of Africa. But ones would not agree, but we care not, for truth can only be that which it is. So now let us continue. Even that's connected to Haile, because of the twisting and turning and the strength and power of the circle, and all connected to Havilah. And so now the Pihon increased water poured forth, overflowing the Nile once again. We don't hear the Jordan River ever overflowing. At least we don't know of it to be the case. Now, river flow out, excuse me. And so we're on Pishon. Overflowing rivers flow out of the Garden of Eden. Now, interesting, it says Hebrew name of Colchians, Colchians. Oh, okay, here's another connection. We know that the Pihon is in fact in Africa, in Ethiopia. Now it says here that Hebrew name for the Pishon is Chalcians. That's kind of sounds like Chaldeans. And then it says here that the Samaritan interpretation of Pishon is the Nile. So, but clearly to the authorities that is of none effect. Now Exodus chapter 2 verse 3 is actually referenced, and we have in this reference the river Iapo, Iapo, and Iapo, Iepo, almost exclusively the Nile. And I mean, there's very many different references that we could go to, but let us kind of okay, so now we have here Ezekiel chapter 32 verse 2 references a river, and the Blue Letter Bible Dictionary calls it the arms of the Nile, because it saved Egypt, or welcomed Egypt, or something like that. We didn't really take all that well, all that carefully jotted down notes, but we're just trying to present a case here, that which is obvious. We shouldn't even have to be doing this, but because of the lunacy of this mad world false system, we have to. So this is connected to the you lie, and you lie is interesting because it's like you lie. It's even kind of resembling Elohai, almost like Elohim and Elohe, kind of like that one verse, my God. Now let us continue. Okay, and it goes on to a root meaning yam, iyam, and which is referring to a lake, ocean, from its boiling and foaming, the sea, sometimes yam is sometimes referencing south, or in some cases west. And now that all makes sense, because of Ben Yamin and yam and time and whatever, yom. And even IOU, the yod, the id. But let us go on forth. Now, we have here, oh, basically, We just wanted to introduce also the word champagne in Old Testament. If ones look up that word champagne, the Blue Letter Bible Dictionary would lead ones to the word Araba. And that is interesting itself because we could clearly connect that to the Yoruba peoples in Western Ethiopia, excuse me, in Western Ethiopia. And it says here arid, sterile region, desert. And here's something interesting. It goes on to say extends as far to the Atlantic. So it says Elanitic Gulf. So we're thinking that's an attempt to hide the fact that it's probably speaking of the Ethiopic Ocean, the Araba. And now that word breaks down into Arabe in the Ethiopic, and it is to set evening, grow dark. And this is relative to the sun, so the west basically. The coming down, the setting of the sun, to wander. And that word breaks off into Arab, and now we have mix, interweave, exchange articles. And so now we have the whole merchants and the West Coast, the Arabe and the Yoruba, and the trading of the illegal, the crimes of against humanity, the illegal act of slave trade and stuff like that. And so, I mean, there's so much information that we could kind of like go into. For example, I guess we'll just put this out there, like the Gospel of Kiddush Johannes, Wangela, the Saint John, chapter 3, verse 23, refers John to baptizing in the Aeon, and we know that to be a direct connection to the Pihon and the Gion. Okay, forgive me, we kind of forgot how, but there is much information that kind of connects those. And so and we kind of forgot where ones could even come across that information, forgive me. But we'll just conclude there because we kind of forgot a lot of different connections that we wanted to present. But basically, we accept the Jordan River to be the Nile, and all scripture is actually referencing locations within Ethiopia. And we need to make mention that Arab and no, forgive me, that rivers and streams and all these words, they the root the main root meaning of some of these verses, of some of these words, it comes down to a happy face, to flow, to shine like a beam, light together. And so this is basically Rastafari revealing the glory of the Almighty in our walk, in our daily lives, never being ashamed. We need not to be ashamed. This is as the sun shineth our countenance, as if the sun shineth in our strength. This is the Ethiop. This is the burnt faces, the illuminated faces revealing truth, the glory reflecting the glory of the Almighty, in the flesh. This is so many different ways to put this, to bring this evidence forth. But basically, we Rastafari are that light shining. If one's reference Genesis, many scholars, falsely so-called, get confused because there is a creation of lights within the heavens to illuminate the earth, and then there's the stars and the moon and the suns. Well, do the math. Some of these illuminators are in fact Rastafari, bringing forth the truth and shining bright, shining, letting the light shine bright, which is our righteousness, our black Lord and Savior, Jesus Christos, our Father, Kedamawi, Haile Selassie of Ethiopia, and beautiful Zion, Ethiopia, the birthplace of all. So with that, I guess we would just like to conclude. We give thanks to all and all. Shalom. Rastafari.